Please stand. Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise. With a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. His love endures forever. For the life has been reborn. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise. Sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong, forever God is with us, forever, forever. From the rising to the setting sun, his love endures forever. By the grace of God we will carry on, his love endures forever. Sing praise. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong, forever God is with us, forever, forever. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong, forever God is with us, forever, forever. Forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever. 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 Forever and ever. Forever.
Conquer the grave.
Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Savior, He can move those mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Please be seated. Every secret, every shame, every fear, every pain, leave inside the dark. But that's not who we are. We are children of the day. Wake up, sleeper, lift your head. We were meant for more than this. Fight the shadows, conquer death. Make the most of the time we have left. We are the light of the world. We are the city on a hill. We are the night of the world. And we gotta, we gotta, we gotta let the light shine. We are the light of the world. We are the city on a hill. We are the light of the world. And we gotta, we gotta, we gotta let the light shine. Let the light shine. Let the light shine. We are called to spread the news. Tell the world the simple truth. Jesus came to save. There's freedom in His name, so let it all break through. We are the light of the world. We are the city on a hill. We are the light of the world. And we gotta, we gotta, we gotta let the light shine. We are the light of the world. We are the city on a hill. We are the light of the world, and we gotta, we gotta, we gotta let the light shine. Let the light shine, let the light shine. We are the light, we are the light, we are the light. So let your light shine brighter. We are the light, we are the light, we are the light. Jesus, You are the light, You are the light, You are the light. We will lift You high. Shine, shine. We are the light of the world. We are the city on a hill. We are the light of the world. And we gotta, we gotta, we gotta let the light shine. We are the light of the world. We are the city on a hill. We are the light of the world, and we gotta, we gotta, we gotta let the light shine.
We are the light of the world. We are the city on a hill. We are the light of the world, and we gotta let the light shine. We are the light of the world. We are the city on a hill. We are the light of the world, and we gotta let the light shine. Let your light shine. Let your light shine. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. Worship Your holy name. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord. My strength is failing, the end draws near, and my time has come. Still my soul sing Your praise on and near. 10,000 years and then forevermore, forevermore. The Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name, sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name, I worship Your holy name. I worship Your holy name. Please stand for the last song.
If I told you my story, you would hear hope that wouldn't let go. If I told you my story, you would hear love that never gave up. If I told you my story, you would hear life, but it wasn't mine. If I should speak, then let it be of the grace that is greater than all my sin. Of when justice was served and where mercy wins, of the kindness of Jesus that draws me in. Oh, to tell you my story is to tell of me. If I told you my story, you would hear victory over the enemy. And if I told you my story, you would hear freedom that was won for me. And if I told you my story, you would hear life overcome the grave. If I should speak, then let it be of the grace that is greater than all my sin. Of when justice was served and where mercy wins, of the kindness of Jesus that draws me. Tell you my story is to tell me. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior. For the grace that is greater than all my sin. Of when justice was served and where mercy wins, of the kindness of Jesus that draws me in. Oh, to tell you my story is to tell of the grace that is greater than all my sin. Now when justice was served and where mercy went, of the kindness of Jesus that draws me in. Oh, to tell you my story is to tell of Him. Oh, to tell my story is to tell of me. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day.
Father, we do worship you this morning. We are here to worship. We're here to give thanks for all you've done for us. Innumerable things, things we could never be able to thank you for fully. Lord, we stand in awe of you, of your graciousness in our lives. We look around the world, we see people who are suffering,
people who are in deep need, people who are being murdered this very day, this very hour. Beheadings, oh my goodness, Lord. We are so blessed. Lord, it's our job now, for whom much is given, much is required. It's our job to go out, spread this good news. We're not happy because necessarily we live in America. That's a good reason to be happy. But we're happy because you live inside of us. We have your first. We have your mercy. We have your forgiveness. We have life. We have a mission in life. We have a calling. And Lord, we are on pursuit to fulfill that call. Even those of us who are senior citizens can still serve in a powerful way. Thank you that you love us, that you care about us, that you know our name, and that you have a plan for our life and you're guiding our life. Thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, thank you, Toby, and good morning. Welcome to church here this morning. Am I on high back there, Andy? That sounded very loud. Well, good morning. Welcome. Hope everyone is being blessed here today and hope you brought your appetite with you. We do have a taco bar that is set up, and so hopefully you'll stick around after that. I know we have a couple people being baptized here today, and of course, if anyone showed up today and God puts it on their heart and you want to join us in baptism, you're free and welcome to be baptized as well this morning. After church, I'm just going to get together with anyone who wants to be baptized. We're going to sit over here, and we just have a little cheat sheet for you that we're going to kind of walk through just to make sure we understand what baptism is all about. And of course, you know, baptism is very similar to the message here today. It's an outward expression of an inward working. And that's what baptism is, as Jesus is going to talk to this lawyer and this Pharisee with us here this morning. And that is what he's going to talk about. He's going to talk about hypocrisy. He's going to talk about these religious leaders who were so bent on these outward obediences, which are important, but Jesus says they need to be combined with an inward obedience, that the heart needs to be obedient to God, not just these outward works that we do. Otherwise, Jesus would say that is the definition of hypocrisy, to have the motivations of the heart be sinful and evil and wicked, and yet we are portraying something differently. Jesus would say, clean the inside and let it match the outside. And so, very powerful stuff, but that's what baptism is it's an inward relationship with Jesus Christ through his Holy Spirit, that when you're being baptized, you are reckoning yourself just as Christ Jesus was crucified, buried. The picture to you and I in baptism is we are dying to that old man, we're dying to ourselves, and we are coming up out of the water as Jesus did, as new creations in Christ. And so what a beautiful thing. And we're going to do that before our brothers and sisters, because I believe the Bible tells us we are to do this publicly, to do it to the glory of the Lord, to acknowledge Jesus before men. And so look forward to that and pray that you guys will stick around and join us over there. We have a lot of food, so please stick around and enjoy the time. I think Toby's going to lead us in some acapella, some worship, and then we'll feast and we'll do the baptism. So with that, if you brought your Bible here this morning, we're going to get right into the study of Luke chapter 11. We're going to look at verses 37 to the end of the chapter. I'm going to begin reading here at verse 37, and after I pray one more time here this morning. Father in heaven, thank you for this day, Lord. Thank you for this opportunity, Lord, to come boldly before your throne of grace. Lord, to sit and to hear your word taught corporately. And Jesus, I thank you for the infallibility of your word. I thank you for your word that does not change, that you do not change. Our hearts can change, our minds can change, but God, you never change. And so thank you for leading us here to the rock, Lord. And I pray that you would speak to us, you would minister to us, and Lord, that you would forgive us in advance for those areas that you are going to mention to us, that you are going to bring to light here today as you are reflecting yourself to us this morning through your word. And so, Father, I pray that your word would do the work that you're sending it forth to do in each and every heart. Lord, we thank you for your grace, for your mercy, for your forgiveness. And thank you for those, Lord, who are going to be baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit here today. Lord, surround them with your angels. Lord, equip them, prepare their steps, give them the strength, plug them into this body, Lord. And what a glorious thing, Lord. Bless them, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. And so Luke chapter 11, beginning here at verse 37, says, "Now when he had spoken, a Pharisee asked him to have lunch with him, and he went in and reclined at the table. When the Pharisee saw it, he was surprised, and he had not first ceremonially washed before the meal. But the Lord said to him, 'Now you Pharisees clean the outside of the cup and of the platter, but inside of you, you are full of robbery and wickedness.' Verse 40 says, 'You foolish ones, did not he who made the outside make the inside also? But give that which is written, or that which is within, as charity, and then all these things are clean for you.' Verse 42 says, 'But woe to you Pharisees, for you pay tithe of mint and rue and every kind of garden herb, and yet disregard justice and the love of God. But these are the things you should have done without neglecting the others. Woe to you Pharisees, for you love the chief seats in the synagogue and the respectful greetings in the marketplace. Woe to you, for you are like concealed tombs, and the people who walk over them are unaware of it." So Jesus here, again, is just milling about. Of course, God is always being directed. Jesus is being directed as well. But milling about meaning that whenever there was an opportunity or an invitation from somebody, Jesus would accept it. Here, a Pharisee comes to him and invites him to his house to have lunch. And I love that Jesus, knowing their hearts, how their hearts were evil and wicked, especially towards Jesus, that Jesus didn't take that personally, that Jesus still went in and had lunch with this Pharisee. And I love that Jesus never shies away from opportunities. But here's, I think, the problem is that this Pharisee, I guarantee you, had no idea what he was in store for. I think if this Pharisee had any idea what he was in store for, he probably would not have invited Jesus to come have lunch. But here's a simple truth for you and I. Oftentimes, we come to Jesus with these preconceived ideas, and we are often surprised sometimes the things that Jesus has to say to us. And I think it's important that we listen to what Jesus has to say to us, and that those are the words that we are looking for. And so here, this Pharisee invites him for lunch. Jesus obliges. But notice that this Pharisee was a little upset or confused that Jesus didn't first go through this ceremonial washing process. Now, I'll tell you, this ceremonial washing, according to the Pharisees and the rabbis, was a very serious law. They felt and they held this law of ceremonial cleanliness and washing before you eat, they held this to the same standard of fornication. They believed that if you did not do this ceremonial washing before you eat, then you were unclean, and it's as the sin of fornication. I'll tell you that in the days of Jesus, they held this so high that if a rabbi or a Pharisee failed to do it properly, I might add, that they were excommunicated from the synagogue. And so this was something that they held to a very high standard. And Jesus here, being a teacher, would come in and sit and not go through this ceremonial washing. Now, this ceremonial washing was insane, the way the Pharisees set the bar. It's a picture of a spiritual cleanliness. So their desire was right. They wanted to be spiritually clean and pure. before the Lord, but how they would portray that to people, that they were being spiritually cleansed or that they were righteous, was by going through this ceremonial washing. Now, what they would do often before they would eat is they would get a special water, I might add. It was a water that was stored in a special stone vessel. And this water was set apart, although it was just water. But to them, it was a special water, a holy water, you might say, that was only used for this ceremonial purposes. So you can't just use regular water to go through this process. You have to go through this special water. That should raise a red flag right away. Just like we're going to be doing a baptism over here. And I'll tell you, that's regular Tehachapi water. But I have something special for you here today. When I was in Israel, I actually bought a little vial for about $15. The Jews know how to make money, I might add. But it is water from the Jordan River. So that is going to be holy water over there because I'm going to pour the holy water in there. This is the same kind of mentality. Now, symbolically, I think that's pretty cool, right? That's the point. But that water isn't going to make you any more spiritually clean than the water in the Jordan. It's the heart that needs to be cleansed, not the body. But here's what they would do. The special holy water, they would take an exact amount. Many believe it was like the size of an egg. So that small amount of water, and what they would do is they'd roll their sleeves up. They'd hold their hands up like this. They would pour water very carefully to make sure it hits the tip of the fingers first. Make sure it runs down the palm to the sleeve. Then they would hold their hand this way. They would take their other hand and they would gently wash like this. Then they would get the rest of the water. Now point their hand down. Make sure to hit the palm before the fingers to get the water then to wash down off the fingers onto the ground. And then they were ceremonially unclean. A very vigorous ritual, because I might add, it wasn't just at the beginning of the meal. They did that through every course of the meal. And you know the Jewish seders, it was what, 6 or 7 courses. So every time between each course, here's your salad, here's this, you got to go through this exact process. Otherwise, you could be excommunicated from the synagogue because you're spiritually unclean. So this is what Jesus didn't do. It's not saying that Jesus was a slob and he didn't have hygiene and he didn't wash his hands before he ate. No, it's a ceremonial procedure, process that they held this high standard to. This is what Jesus didn't do. And so here, what did it say? They were surprised that he didn't do this. Now, Jesus here in verse 39, what did he say? He said, "Now you Pharisees clean the outside of the cup and of the platter, but inside of you are full of robbery and wickedness." He says, "You foolish ones, did not he who made the outside make the inside also? But give that which is within as charity, and then all things are clean for you." You see, these rabbis were performing these ceremonies trying to portray and trying to maintain a spiritual purity. And so I can imagine Jesus is sitting here. That takes a lot of discipline, doesn't it? That's like the Mormon religion. They are probably the most disciplined of the religious people. And that's commendable. But remember, we aren't saved according to anything that we can do for God, because anything that we do with our best motivations, with our best efforts, is still seen as yet filthy rags before God. And so despite this extreme discipline, that's commendable. I play sports, and to be good at sports, you have to discipline yourself. You often have to have a very strict diet even to get your body fat down, to increase your muscle. You have to exercise vigorously to get your lungs to be able to continue to breathe properly as you're engaged in these activities. It is a tremendous amount of discipline. The Bible says even in Timothy that physical discipline is good, but spiritual discipline is much better, is much more beneficial to you and I. But here, these religious leaders, I have to think that Jesus is looking at them and saying, wow, you know, you are so good about making sure of this cleanliness. I just wish that you were that concerned with the cleanliness of your heart that way. I wish you were as willing to go through these extreme processes to keep your heart pure before me. You see, oftentimes people will use these rituals, like the religious leaders, they will use these rituals instead of looking to the sacrifice that God has given to spiritually cleanse them. It's easier for people sometimes to follow these rules or these ordinances to feel like they are spiritually clean so that they don't have to accept that offering, that self-sacrificing offering that God has given to us. It's easier. Why? Because I don't need any help. I can cleanse myself. I can be responsible for my own goodness. This is the picture here. So these religious leaders were careful. They were very careful to try to maintain this appearance of righteousness, but instead, they were neglecting the inner reality of it. You see, there's nothing wrong with this. In fact, we're called to obedience. We're called to these outward works. But the problem is that there we have to understand the inner reality of those works. It has to come from the heart, and it has to be a mutual working together. And so Jesus says, you are foolish. Why did he call them foolish? Well, because they were clean outside, but the inside was filthy. And so Jesus is saying, you're not even understanding your own folly. You think you're clean because the outside's clean, but the inside is filthy. Remember, we looked at that 2 weeks ago in the Gospel of John. When John talks about where all of this evil and hatred and fornication, where it all comes from, it doesn't come from the corner. It doesn't come from the guy across the street. It doesn't come from anywhere else but in the heart. Remember, he said it's the heart where all of these evils come from. And so this is the picture here that Jesus says, you are foolish because of these things. Listen to what Paul says to the Philippian church in chapter 2 at verse 14. He says, do all things without grumbling or disputing so that you will prove yourself to be blameless and innocent. You see, it's not just doing these deeds, but it's doing them with an obedient heart to God. It's not doing them because I have to do them. I guarantee you, none of those religious leaders, they had to be thinking in the back of their minds, this is silly, right? I mean, come on, this is silly. How many times do I have to do this, right? Well, you're already doing it there with the wrong heart. You know, this picture of the Pharisees and this foolishness and hypocrisy, here's a good example of what it looks like. Picture a soldier who day and night is under very rigorous orders. They train. They wake up in odd hours of the night and they do all of these drills and they're training and they're doing all of these exercises. That's very commendable. But a hypocrite would be like that soldier who has all of this training under his belt, who is going through it rigorously, who's maybe even perfected it, but then he goes into the battlefield and all of that is forgotten, or all of that is not used, or they become fearful and they run away from the battle. This is what Jesus is saying. It has to be both. These outward obediences are good, but it needs to be an obedient heart. Otherwise, these outward obediences aren't going to cleanse you, because it's the heart that is evil and that is sinful and that needs to be cleansed. And so we should do our good deeds with the right heart and a pure heart. That way the outside of the cup will match the inside. And then Jesus would not say, as he did to these religious leaders, you fools, you are hypocrites. And so what does he say here in verse 42? He gives them a list of these woes. Now these woes aren't, you know, Jesus saying, you guys are really irritating me, you know, and I'm upset with you. No, these woes are really divine warnings that Jesus is giving. You see, these woes are pretty serious. You think about the Old Testament, a lot of the prophets, what would they say to the people? Woe to you, O Israel. These warnings that say, hey, these are divine warnings. Unless you change, something is going to happen here. There are going to be consequences. Isaiah 5, verses 8 through 13. Isaiah gives two very profound woes to the nation of Israel. So we see this common theme of God giving woes to his people. Here, Jesus is giving woes to the religious leaders. But let me tell you, just because we're sitting here in the church and we are under the new covenant with Jesus Christ, doesn't say that Jesus doesn't tell the church woe either. Jesus does tell the church woe. In the book of Revelation, chapters 2 and 3, Jesus speaks to seven of the churches. And he gives them these warnings. These are the same things as woes. Remember the church of Ephesus. Jesus said, hey, you guys are doing a lot of great works out there. You're going out there. You're feeding the homeless. You're doing all of these great works. But he says, I have this against you. In other words, woe to you because you have left your first love. You're still going through these outward obediences, but your heart is far from me. Inside your heart, you are cursing those you are trying to preach the gospel to, or you are hating them in your heart. You're like Jonah, who would say, they're not worthy of God's grace. You see, the church of Pergamum, Jesus would say, woe to you, Pergamum, because you are allowing this false teaching. He would say, woe to you, Thyatira, for your idol worship. He would say to Sardis, here's, I think, the picture of what this church fell into was exactly what these Pharisees and lawyers fell into. To the church of Sardis, Jesus would say, you have the name that you are alive, but you are dead. Right? You have the name that you're alive. You are out there looking like a Christian, but inside, you are dead. Your heart is not being obedient to me. You see, these are profound truths that Jesus will continue to echo through all of eternity, guys, I might say. Remember, there's only three things I learned at our marriage retreat this Saturday. Three things that never change. God, his word, and what was the other one, Nathan? Put you on the spot, huh? God, his word, and there's one other one. I'll have to get back to you on it. But God and his word never change. You and I will change, right? But what a profound thing. So these woes are for you and I as well. We can fall into these same traps. I'll tell you what it's called. It's called legalism. That is what legalism is. And we think, oh, you know, well, I'd rather be legalist than one of those wishy-washy Christians. They're both in themselves missing the mark. They're both falling short. You see, legalism is people who would say, I want people to see me doing these works so that they know that I'm a Christian. That's legalism. I do them so that people will see me as a Christian. That's legalism. You see, Jesus would say something completely different. Jesus would say in John 13, 35, a new command I give to you. Right? That you are to love one another. And he goes on to say that by this, your love for one another, people will know that you are my disciples. So they had it backwards. Legalism has it backwards. They think that the better that I look to people, the more that they will see that I'm a Christian. But yet Jesus himself says, no, it's your love, my love, and your love for one another that will prove that we are his disciples. And so what an amazing thing that we can often get it backwards, guys. We're going through all of these good works with the wrong heart, and Jesus would say that's foolish, that it's hypocrisy. Turn with me to the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 6, because again, he's speaking to the religious leaders here, but it's relevant to you and I. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 1, Jesus says this. He says, beware of practicing your righteousness before men to be noticed by them. Right, for whatever reason, but you're doing these things either to be noticed by men so that they say, oh, he's a Christian, or we'll see in a minute The religious leaders just loved the celebrity of it. They loved being treated like celebrities. Oh, don't we see that in the church a lot today? Man, I think a lot of the churches should just give up being pastors and go run for office, and that's not a bad thing. We need good Christian politicians, but to see a lot of the hierarchy in the Christian circles, it's a celebrityism. It's the same thing the religious leaders were guilty of. They were celebrities. But here he says, beware of practicing your righteousness before men to be noticed by them. Otherwise, you have no reward with your Father who is in heaven. So he says, you know what? If you're going to do these things and you want your applause from men, there's your reward. Because when it comes to you standing before me, there is going to be no reward. So you have your reward here on earth. But look at verse 2. He gives us three examples of how we can do things with the wrong heart just to do them, thinking that we're somehow spiritually pure, our hearts are right, that we are walking by grace through faith. But verse 2, Jesus says, when you give to the poor, do not sound a trumpet before you as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets so that they may be honored by men. Right? It's the same thing. The religious leaders, Jesus is going to tell them, hey, you love the chief seats in the house. In the synagogues, the chief seats would have been the seats that were up on the platform that were facing the congregation. They loved to sit there and look at people looking at them. They loved the prestige. The same thing here. Hey, when you give, if you're going to give to somebody, don't make sure and announce it to everyone. Hey, like the religious leaders that would ring a bell, you know, before they drop their tithe in the offering, wanting everyone to see, whoa, you know. Or some churches, they'll put your names on the back wall, you know, the highest givers, you know, are up here, and then it works its way down. It's crazy. Why? Jesus would say, do these things in secret. Right? You do these things in private and your God will reward you and he'll reward you openly for these things. But when you do it backwards and you're looking for people to say, wow, he must be really spiritual. Right? Oh, look at him. Well, you're more concerned with people looking at you than looking at the Lord. It's the heart. If you're doing it for God, it shouldn't matter what people see or think. But our physical side, our human side, right? We are still human beings. We're faulty. We like to be liked. We like people to see us doing good things instead of bad things, hopefully. But when it comes down to it, that's what being obedient from the heart means. Pastor Mike said it this Saturday. It's this consciousness of everything I say or I do that I'm saying in my heart, is this going to be pleasing and glorifying to God? Even if no one's looking, that's the key. That is what it means to be obedient from the heart. That I don't just pray these long prayers before you, that I pray these long prayers on my bedside when no one else is around. That I don't ring the bell and let everyone know how much I give to the church. I just give to the church. Why? Because I'm giving it to God. The church will benefit from it, but I'm giving it first to God. See, that's the difference. That's the obedience of the heart. It's not because I'm commanded to, right? And I have to do these things. Well, those are good. Those are outward obediences. But if you're doing it with the wrong heart, then it's of no value. That's what 1 Corinthians 13 is all about. If you do all these great things, yet you have not love, you profit nothing. If you're not doing it with the right heart, an obedient heart to the Lord. You see, verse 43, it's what he says here. In verse 43, I was still in Matthew. Okay, so he says, when you give, don't sound the trumpet and this and that. Verse 5 of Matthew 6, he says, when you pray, you aren't to stand and pray in the synagogue or on the street corners so that you may be seen by men. And if you do that, that's fine. But it should mean you do it because you're already doing it at home. Right? That's the simple truth. That's what Jesus is saying. Hey, don't stop doing these things. You should have these outward obediences, but you need to make sure that the heart is obedient as well. Otherwise, it's hypocrisy. It's hypocrisy. Look at the next one in verse 16. You can read the whole chapter, but I'm just skimming the three examples he gives us of how we can be hypocrites when we give, when we pray. And verse 16 says, when you fast, do not put on a gloomy face as the hypocrites do, for they neglect their appearance so that they will be noticed by men that they are fasting, right? They come in and, I'm just so hungry, man. I'm on a 41-day fast for the Lord, man. Right? Jesus would say, no. Go take a shower. Clean up. Present yourself as you're just one of the people. Don't come out with this, I'm the hero, I'm a super saint. Do it as unto the Lord, guys. That's the key when you're doing it from the heart. And that's really where our relationship with Jesus starts and where it finishes. It's where it starts. As we mature in Christ Jesus, we never stop with that obedience from the heart. Otherwise, you get into legalism, you get into all this weird stuff, you get into the routines, you get into the rituals, you get into this, okay, before you come to church, everyone roll up your sleeves, we're going to pour this special water down your hands, we're going to do all, you get into all kinds of weird things. But if we just let Jesus Christ live and rule on our hearts, this world would be a completely different world. That's it. That's what the disciples did. They turned the world right side up, 12 men. Who were given to Jesus Christ from the heart. Meaning they would have done what they did regardless if it was a million people or if it was two people. Or if it was no people. Why? Because they're doing it for the Lord. They're not doing it for anyone else. So when there's no reward, then the people won't flee. Right? What does Jesus say about the hired hand? Right? As long as he's getting his pay, he'll be willing to render his services. But the minute that he doesn't get his pay, he's out of here, right? That's what happens. That's what Jesus is talking about here. These chief seats, I already talked about it. That's their front seats in the front row. They love the attention of people staring at them. Whereas Paul would say to the Galatian church in Galatians 1:10, he says this, for am I now seeking the favor of men or of God? Or am I striving to please men? If I were still striving to please men, I would not be a bondservant to Jesus Christ. You can't be a men pleaser and be a bondservant of Jesus Christ. You can't do it. That's where I have a problem with these guys who are, you know, looking for popularity and drawing these crowds because they feel that the more people they can reach, the more votes that we can get out there and get. And that's, it's a good concept, right? But biblically, spiritually, Jesus would almost say the complete opposite. It's about the heart. And so what an amazing thing. That is what legalism is. People will only know, or the thinking that people will have to know or see that we are Christians because of the things that we're doing and not yet our love for one another. What a sad, sad reality here. And so Jesus, back in the Gospel of Luke, at verse 44, he says, woe to you, for you are like concealed tombs, and the people who walk over them are unaware of it. And so, again, he's speaking to this hypocrisy, and here he's talking about an Old Testament law that they weren't to walk upon graves, because if they were to come in contact with the grave or walk over a grave, they would be unclean for 7 days. And so Jesus is saying that these Pharisees are like these graves that are unmarked. You see, they would often whitewash the tombs so that you wouldn't accidentally walk over them and then become unclean. So Jesus is saying these Pharisees are like these unmarked tombs that people are walking over and not even knowing it and being unclean. In other words, you can say he's saying you are blind Pharisees and you are leading blind people. A very, very stern warning that Jesus is giving them here. He's saying, in other words, everyone has the right, I believe, I think the Bible teaches, the freedom to either enter into eternal life God's way through Jesus Christ, or you have the opportunity to reject him, of course. But If you choose not to enter the kingdom of heaven, that is bad enough. But now if you stumble others, if you lead others into your sin and your folly, then that punishment will be much more severe. It's one thing for you and I to just choose to go to hell, but when we choose to lead a bunch of people to hell, there is going to be a great rebuke, a great punishment for that. Toby said it himself, to whom much is given, much is going to be required. And you know, that shouldn't just be a warning to the Pharisees, a warning to pastors, a warning to leaders, but let me bring it down to all of our level. That should be a warning to anyone who is leading. And if you have kids, you're a leader. I believe the warning is the same. It's bad enough if you want to choose your life to live like a heathen, but when you're drawing and leading other people into that same life, it's a pretty severe warning. And so we need to be aware. And how do we do that? How do we keep our hearts pure and clean before the Lord? Well, reading His Word and washing our minds in the Word will also wash our hearts, purify our hearts. David would cry out continually, Lord, give me clean hands and a pure heart. Jesus would say, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. It's that whole idea of, is this pleasing to God? Is what I am saying and what I am doing, is it pleasing to God regardless of what people say or see? That is the relationship. That is a pure heart. That is what Jesus says. When you have a pure heart, you will see God. Why? Because you are desiring God. You are fulfilling the greatest commandment. Love the Lord your God with all of your heart, mind, soul, and strength. And then love your neighbor as you love yourself. Jesus says that's the extent. That is the full law, including the second part of the law. Not just the 10, all 600 commandments in the law. You have fulfilled them all in just that one. And so here again, the warning is, if you are leading people astray, you are lost. And if you are leading other people to be lost, then there is going to be great condemnation for that. And so Jesus here in verse 45, he says, one of the lawyers now said to him in reply, teacher, when you say this, you insult us too. But he said, woe to you lawyers as well. For you weigh men down with burdens hard to bear, while you yourself will not even touch the burdens with one of your fingers. Woe to you, for you build the tombs of the prophets, and it was your fathers who killed them. So you are witnesses and approve the deeds of your fathers, because it was they who killed them, and you build their tombs. Verse 49 says, for this reason also the wisdom of God said, I will send to them prophets and apostles, and some of them they will kill, and some they will persecute, so that the blood of all of the prophets shed since the foundation of the world may be charged against this generation, from the blood of Abel to the blood of Zechariah, who was killed between the altar and the house of God. Yes, I tell you, it shall be charged against this generation. Verse 52, he says, woe to you lawyers, for you have taken away the key of knowledge. You yourselves did not enter, and you hinder those who are entering. You see what legalism does? It takes away the key of knowledge and understanding. But Jesus here, I love this, as if this Pharisee wasn't getting reproved right in front of everyone. Now this lawyer, remember the lawyers would have been the experts in the law. Not only were they experts in the interpretation of the law, but also the practical side of the interpretation. And so this lawyer pipes in. Maybe he thought he was smarter than the religious leader. But honestly, I think he would have been better just to be quiet. Right? And doesn't the Word tell us that? That we should be quick to listen and slow to speak? James 1:9. That's why God gave us two ears and one mouth, that we should listen twice as much as we speak. But no, this guy wants to pop in and you know, say, hey, you insulted me, Jesus. Well, like I prayed, oftentimes when we come to Jesus and we're seeking His wisdom, His way, oftentimes we are surprised by the answer that Jesus gives us. Why? Because Jesus isn't necessarily concerned about the external affairs. Jesus is always intent on fixing the issue of the heart. That's why his word is a double-edged sword, able to pierce the heart, not just cut off the arm. It pierces the heart, and it's able to discern the thoughts and the intents of the heart. Who else can do that in your life? No one. God can, though, right? God can. And so this lawyer comes to him and says, "You insulted us." And what does Jesus say? "Woe to you also, lawyers, experts in the law, experts in interpretation, experts in telling the people how they should do the right things." He says, "You lay up these heavy burdens on the people, and you yourselves don't go through them." Well, I can go on and on about the legalism that these lawyers would do. One is, I'll just give you an example on the Sabbath. The law was you weren't to carry anything. Now, remember what the Sabbath was even created for, right? It was created so that man would rest. But yet they take that simple commandment of God. God basically said, look, you're to work 6 days, work hard, right? Go out and work. Then on that seventh day, though, the way I wired you and I made you, you need rest. So go to your tent, right? Have a nice meal, relax, enjoy your family, play Scrabble, right? Rest. You need rest. But what did they do? They took that and they were trying to find every little loophole, wiggle room they could. So here's one thing they did. They were supposed to just rest, right? They got into all this crazy stuff. Then, so they weren't supposed to carry anything on the Sabbath. But they still wanted to carry stuff. So instead of carrying it with their hands, the palms up, I guess they had an idea that that's technically carrying something when you're clenching it. So what they would do is they would pick it up with the back of their hands and they would carry it. But hey, we're not breaking the Sabbath because I'm not carrying anything. Right? I'm going to put this burden on you, but then I'm going to try to figure out a way to, you know, get through. Don't lawyers do the same thing today? Right? If the glove don't fit, you must acquit. Right? I mean, just goofy, goofy stuff. But yet, they do it and they get away with it. Why? Because, well, we're held to that law, but there's interpretations of the law. There's all kinds of things. Don't we love to just try to overcomplicate things? Or we love to try to put our own interpretation. I've heard so many people say that. Yeah, well, that's your interpretation of the Bible. No, it's God's interpretation of the Bible. We may have different ways to explain it, but if it's a different truth, then that's a problem. But that's what we like to do. Well, does that really, you know, fornication, does that include like looking at pornography? Is that, you know, I'm not out there actually doing these acts, right? Well, I'm not committing adultery, am I? Yes. Jesus says that if you look at a man or woman with lust in your heart, that is the issue, right? It's not the outward obedience. It's the inwardness of the heart. This is where the fornication starts. Long before you go actually pull the trigger or, you know, make the phone call or do whatever you're going to do, it starts right here. That's why Jesus says obedience from the heart. And then you will be obedient outside. And you will match. You won't be that hypocrite. You won't be that cup that is only clean on the outside but full of rotten filth and dirt and sin on the inside. And so verse 47, what did he say here? He said, "Woe to you, for you build tombs of the prophets, and it was your fathers who killed them. So you are witnesses and approve the deeds of your fathers because it was they who killed them, and you build their altars." In other words, he's saying you're respecting the prophets and you're building these tombs, but yet your fathers were the ones who killed them. Let me put that in today's terms. I can sit here in my own self-righteousness and say, you know what, if I was Peter and Jesus called me out onto the sea, I would have never had that lapse of faith like Peter. Right? Here they are building these monuments to these dead prophets while there is a living prophet right in front of them. Right? How easy is it to do that? To glorify the past? Well, that tomb can't speak anymore, right? I mean, it's just That's what they're doing. They're building these tombs to these prophets who their fathers killed, and they're rejecting a very living prophet right in front of themselves. Jesus says, woe to you. Verse 49, he says, for this reason also, through God's wisdom, he says, I will send the prophets and apostles, and some of them will kill and some of them will persecute. A radical prophecy that Jesus says through these. Little did they know, Jesus knew that they themselves were going to be guilty in just a few weeks of marching this prophet, Jesus Christ, to Calvary and killing him, just as their fathers did to the Old Testament prophets. And Jesus goes a step further here. He says, not only will I be killed, but listen, the apostles and the disciples, you who are hearing these words, you are going to now go after the disciples and the apostles as well. And so he says to them, woe to you who build these monuments to the dead prophets and you aren't willing to hear the living prophet who is God himself right here in your presence. And so Jesus here prophesying these things. Verse 50 is where we close. He said, and so the blood of all the prophets shed since the foundation of the world will be charged against this generation. From the blood of Abel to the blood of Zechariah, mark that down. That is the first martyr and the last martyr of the Old Testament. Abel, remember Cain and Abel, and Zechariah the prophet, the first and the last martyrs of the Old Testament, who was killed between the altar of the house of God. Yes, I tell you, it shall be charged against this generation. Did anyone listen to the message on Thursday night? Revelation 16. Man, oh man. Talk about God and his vengeance, right? For those who would harm his saints. In Revelation 16, it was speaking of those who were in the tribulation period, who would put faith in Jesus, who were brutally killed, that God had in store for those who would kill those Christians a horrible wrath that was going to come upon them. You see, just like God has great plans and purposes for you and I in this life and in the life to come and rewards, well, God is also just and righteous in the sense that what we sow, we will reap. And if those are sowing to evil and wickedness, they are going to reap those things. They are going to reap the wrath of God. And it is not pretty. They were drinking blood because all of the water had been turned to blood, because that was one of the plagues that God said, because you killed my prophets, here is my wrath upon you. The darkness, the sun becoming so close to the earth that the people were being scorched. I can go on and on, but the point is what Jesus is saying here. The same thing could be said to those who are blind leaders, who are leading other people into the darkness. Not only is your punishment going to be severe, but it's going to be even greater because now you're leading other people into the same darkness. That's why Timothy would say, not many of you should desire to be teachers, because teachers are going to be held to a higher standard. Why? Because people are listening to what he's saying or her. And so don't be quick, because there is going to be accountability. That's why the celebrities need to beware. And they're not all celebrities, but there's one in particular. I mean, I'm not going to name, but he just bought like a $6 million Lamborghini. But I mean, it's just, you're getting your reward now, is what the Bible would say. You're getting that applause. You're getting all that stuff. But man, oh man, I can only imagine. And that's what keeps me humble too. That's what keeps me reverent too. I don't have a $5 million Lamborghini. But, we are going to be responsible. You know, the words that we say, counseling, I go back to it again and again. I'm very careful because you could just say something, you got a million things on your mind, you're listening. That's why Mike even talked Saturday. He should have just taught today. But about listening, how you would be surprised what you can learn by just simply listening to somebody instead of trying to think that you know exactly what they're going through and trying to just listen to what they say. But it could be very important. You could just throw something off the cuff and that person grabs onto that and uses that, and that begins to steer them into a direction that God never intended for them. Now, there is grace. God has grace because I'm human. I'm not the Holy Spirit. You know, I still will make mistakes. But boy, that should be a burning, searing conviction on our hearts. And what I am doing now, is it pleasing to God? And then I should be that way when I'm sharing with other people. Is what I'm saying, because I'm pretty upset right now and this is some view I have and it's not even biblical, but this is what I'm going to tell them? We're going to be responsible for that, guys. Because God is just and God is righteous, and there is a warning here, a woe. And so what does he say here at the end, verse 53? This earpiece is killing me today. Verse 53 says, when he left there, the scribes and the Pharisees began to be very hostile and to question him closely on many subjects, plotting against him to catch him in something he might say. I would say that is a guilty conscience. Right? The word of God spoke to their hearts, exposed them, and people don't like to be exposed. But if we are pure in heart, if we are desiring to love God with all of our heart, well, then we would receive those words. And we would say like David, Lord, give me a clean heart. Give me pure hands, because I have seen that my heart is not pure yet. It's pure in God's sight. We are being sanctified. We are already saved by grace through faith. But Lord, purify my heart. Continue to purify my heart. The closer we get to God, the more we're going to see just how unholy we really are and how holy he is. You see, Mike gave us a great illustration about hypocrisy. It could be a picture of a theater actor who puts the mask on, you know, and we all understand that concept of hypocrisy. You're acting to be something you're not, right? It's what an actor is. But another type of hypocrisy is these pot makers back in the day that would make these beautiful ceramic vases and pots. And if they didn't make it perfectly right and they baked it too high or too fast or whatever and it forms a little crack, well, generally those pots are no good, because once they're cracked, they're going to eventually shatter. But instead of somebody creating one and creating it with an imperfection, instead of throwing it away, they would say, all that time and energy I invested in this, I want to get some return for it, some profit. So what would they do? They'd get some wax. And they'd fill that crack in with wax, and then they would gloss over it so it didn't look like it had a crack. But the problem is that you buy that thing, you take it home, you set it in the sun, and the sun begins to melt the wax, the crack begins to crack, you come out, and there's your pot, a crack pot. It's amazing what the fire of God, the holiness, remember, God is a consuming fire. And anything that comes into contact with it, just like that pot, those flaws are going to be exposed, right? You may put wax. How do we love to do that? We can all be hypocrites, guys. You could be hurting really bad, but yet you feel that, you know, for whatever reason, and you know, you don't want everyone. So you put a smile on, right? That's not a bad form of hypocrisy. It's still hypocrisy, though. So we all understand that concept. But God would say, don't try to cover those cracks. Don't try to cover those imperfections, because when it comes before the sun, when it comes before that all-consuming holy fire that God is, then that testing will show what that pot is. You see, the extreme heat does two things. It's just like the gold. When we heat up, those goldsmiths would heat up that gold to make it pure gold. That heat begins to make all those impurities rise to the top of that gold. They put the gold in a pot and they boil the gold. They melt it, liquefy it. And they would take all the dross, all the impurities that rose to the top, they'd take them off and heat it again and make it pure and purer. You see, that's what we do when we come in contact with God and his word. It's purifying us. It's exposing these cracks. And so in a way, if we are a heart for God and not just our outward obedience, if we have an inward obedience, then we're allowing him to test us like that. We're allowing his word to examine our hearts. And we're saying, wow, you know what? I ain't going to fill that crack anymore. I repent of that. God, forgive me. Now help me. Give me a clean heart. Give me the ability to do these things. Change my heart. You see, because the fire is going to prove what kind of pot it is. And I believe on the day of judgment, there's going to be a lot of pots standing before God that you and I looked at and said, that's truly a good, pure, holy, perfect pot. And it's going to be exposed before God, and we're going to go, I would have never thought that. Or let me take that on the contrary. There may be that pot where we say, I know where that pot's going to be. Only to find on that day, to our surprise, that that was a genuine, pure pot. I believe that firmly. Why? Well, because there's a lot of hypocrisy. There's a lot of people living in hypocrisy. Right? It's the heart. Jesus says the heart is the issue. It's not all these great works. Keep doing the great works. Keep tithing. Remember, Jesus said, keep doing, keep giving, keep praying, keep doing these things. These are good things. But remember, the heart has to be right. You have to be obedient to me in your heart. What a beautiful thing. And I want to close with this, Romans, guys, because this stumbling thing, we need to beware the things that we're saying and trying to, people ask us for, you know, opinions. I don't think should be opinions. You know, we think, well, what is your opinion on something? Well, Mike asked me the other day, you know, what's your opinion on this? And I was like, you know, if we understood that every word that we say, you know, A, we can't take those things back, but B, you know, words are either going to build up or they're going to tear down. That's it. That's it. They're either going to build up something or they're going to tear it down. Try that today. Go home in your marriage and say something really mean and nasty to your spouse. Did I just say that? And see what you get. Or here's a better one, since we're at church. Go say something nice to your husband or wife and see what they do in return. But here's what Paul says to the Roman church. And I pray that tonight you guys would go back through this and really study this in depth. Because I think that this is a lot of what we could really use to understand today in 2021 with all this stuff that is going on around us. I love this portion of scripture. Paul says this about leading others astray, the blind, leading the blind. He says this in verse 12 of Romans 14. He says, so then each one of us will give an account to himself, of himself to God. So he says, therefore, let us not judge one another anymore, but rather determine this, not to put an obstacle or a stumbling block in a brother's way. I know and am convinced in the Lord Jesus that nothing is unclean in itself, but to him who thinks anything to be unclean, to him it is unclean. That is a whole Bible study in itself. Remember, Jesus said that anything you take with gratitude and you thank God for is clean, right? And so he says here, that to somebody who isn't mature or understands that concept, and they think that if they do this, it is sin, well, then the Bible just said, to you, it is sin. Very profound. That's why I tell people when it comes to this whole vaccine thing, I say, what is your conviction? What is your conviction? Right? Don't listen to what somebody else does. You do your research, you pray, you seek God's will and God's heart. But what is your conviction? If your conviction is, I shouldn't get it, then you need to follow that conviction. Because if you sin against that conviction, then you sin against God. But if you don't have a conviction for that, then God, I believe, would say, then God isn't giving you that conviction. Then get the vaccine. Look at verse 15. He says, for if because of food your brother is hurt, you are no longer walking according to love. I find this fascinating. He takes it up a step here. If there's somebody who thinks if I eat this, I'm sinning, And to you, you understand that it's clean. You take it with gratitude. You give God thanks for it. It's clean. But if you were to now go to that one who thinks it's unclean and sit in front of them with a big bowl of it and be slopping it down and saying, what's wrong with you? Have some. You're stumbling them in your faith. You are now no longer walking according to love. Guess what? That is sin to you, even though you have the right and the freedom to eat it. But if you're blatantly putting it out in front of your brother and causing them to stumble, it goes on. Look at this. It says, do not destroy with your food or your freedom or your liberty him from whom Christ has died. Oh, I forgot about that. Jesus didn't just die for me and my convictions. He died for everyone. Right? Don't put a stumbling block. Don't turn people away from Jesus because of your personal convictions. The warning is, what he would say to the Pharisees, you're going to lead people in that direction based on your convictions. Beware. Because your judgment will be even firmer. Because it's not just you sailing away your own ship. You're now trying to bring people into your own convictions. Be careful, the Bible says. Be careful. Be responsible for your conviction. Right? Each has their own conviction. Verse 17 or 16. He says, therefore, do not let what is for you a good thing be spoken of as evil. Verse 17, for the kingdom of God is not eating and drinking. Here it is, right here. Here's what the kingdom of God consists of. Not these things. Not these, even may I say, outward obediences. Here's what the kingdom of God consists of. Righteousness. A righteousness that we don't have, I might add. That only comes from Christ Jesus. A relationship with him, that our hearts are pure because of him, not my righteousness. It's made up of righteousness, peace. Where are you at today? Are you living in this kingdom that consists of righteousness and peace? That's what the kingdom of God is, guys. Not conflict, not uproar, not upheaval. It says right here, the kingdom of God consists of righteousness, peace, and joy. That's why I ponder how we can have peace and joy at a time like this. I said Thursday night, I can't imagine living right now without Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, without the Holy Spirit living within you. That's how we can have joy and peace. It says, in the Holy Spirit, for he who is this way serves Christ. Wait, for he who in this way serves Christ. Right? Not stumbling my brother, not, you know, taking my convictions and holding to my convictions. My convictions aren't your convictions, and I have no right to put my convictions on you. What did I say? What is your conviction? Follow your conviction. We're going to be responsible for our own convictions, not yours. You're not going to be responsible for mine. I'm not going to be responsible for yours. We will each be responsible before God. It's that simple, guys. He says, for he who in this way serves Christ is acceptable to God and approved by men. Interesting. He says, so then we pursue the things which make for peace. Wait a minute. Do I see the church preaching that message today? I'm just asking. So then, are we pursuing the things which make for peace and the building up of one another? Or do we not tear down the work of God for the sake of food, personal convictions? All things indeed are clean, but they are evil for the man who eats and gives offense. Not just sin, evil, he said. Verse 21, it is good not to eat meat. It is good not to eat meat or to drink wine or to do anything by which your brother stumbles. Why is that? Because the first commandment God gives us is to love him. Love him with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength. You got that one figured out yet? You got that one nailed down? Then the second part is what? It's likened to the first too. So it's not like one and two, it's one. It's the second part of one. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. Verse 22, the faith which you have Have as your own conviction before God. Underline that. The faith which you have as your own conviction before God. Happy is he who does not condemn himself in what he approves. Remember what Paul said, something very profound to the Corinthian church. He says, you judge me. You sit there and you judge me. I don't even judge myself, Paul says. Why? Because his judge is God. He does everything as unto God. He is obedient from the heart to God. He's not being obedient to people. That's what they were doing. They were judging him of this and that and that. And he just flat out says, look, you're judging me. I don't even judge myself. Why? Because he was perfect? No. Because he was in Christ. Christ was his judge. That's a higher standard. That means he tried to do the right thing when nobody was around. Right? Why? Because God's always around. God's always present. God is in us. What a powerful thing. He says in verse 23, he says, but he who doubts is condemned if he eats, because his eating is not from faith. And whatever is not from faith is sin. That's why you, as an individual, need to follow your own convictions, your faith. Otherwise, you don't follow that. The Bible says, then that is sin. And if you're causing somebody else to sin because of your own conviction, the Bible says that's evil. That's evil. And so let's pray here this morning. Father in heaven, I just thank you for your word, Lord. I thank you for the truth. Lord, I thank you for your grace, Lord, and your mercy. Jesus, these woes, each and every one of them, speak to me as a man, as a pastor, as a husband, as a father, as a son. And Father, I pray that you would forgive me, Lord. You would cleanse me, Lord, where I fall short, where I have sinned against you. Lord, I pray that you who began this good work, that you would continue this work, and that I would never fall into that trap of trying to put wax in the cracks of that pot. Lord, that I would never try to wax over my sin. That I would never, like Adam and Eve, hide myself from you. But instead, I would be transparent and open before you. And when I'm transparent and open before you, how much easier is it then to be transparent and open before others? That is what you want. Us to be transparent and open and obedient to you, and then let that flow out from us to then touch others. And so, Father, help us, Lord, in this very, very difficult time. We are faced with things daily that no other generation has faced. Mike was saying this Saturday, something like facts or information changes every 72 hours in our mind. Or history maybe changes in 72 hours. Whereas 10, 15, 20 years ago, it would take 10 or 15 years for things to change. But now we have such an evolving, quickly, rapidly changing everything. It's hard. It's hard, God, not to feel like we're in a washing machine and then a dryer on top of it. So, Lord, we need your grace. We need your mercy. I pray that each and every one of us from the heart are saying, God, I don't know all these things. I'm doing the best I can. I'm trusting you with what you've given me, and I pray that you would continue to direct me and lead me in the path that I should go. Help me to be quick to listen and slow to speak. Help me to be forgiving as you have forgiven me. Help me to walk in humility. Compassion. And Father, thank you for sustaining us. Thank you for keeping us healthy. We pray, Lord, you would keep us. You would watch over us. You would protect us. And that you would lift our heads, Father. And that you'd wipe the tears from our eyes as we cry out to you. And Lord, we just thank you. We thank you for who you are and what you're doing in us. We love you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Stand. You're all welcome to come to the baptism and the barbecue and all the good food over there. You must come. It's from the pastor. It goes way beyond me. So.